So last day we were talking about the linear block code, and we have mentioned a few properties of linear block code. One of the important properties of LBC is that if I consider two different codes, like code words, say for example C1 and C2, and if I add them together, I'll be getting a different code word, that will be C3. So if I have a code word like C1, and if I have another code word like C2, then ultimately we will be getting a new code word that will be C3, and which belongs to that particular code set. And this is the property of linear block code, and that property is known as the closure property. And we have also discussed the method of generating the code word from the message vector. So in fact, we have discussed about two different black box. So one was the generator matrix. So we have a generator matrix over here, which is also known as the encoder, a channel encoder. So if this is represented by G, and then accordingly for a particular message vector, the corresponding code word is being represented by M into G. And you know how to construct this G. This generator matrix is nothing but, or it looks something like that. We have this parity matrix, and then ultimately we have this identity matrix. And ultimately, if I just consider the dimension of each of these different vectors, as you understand, for the message vector, it is normally of size 1 cross k, and the code vector is of size 1 cross n. So as a matter of fact, the generator matrix is having a size of k cross n minus k. And this kind of linear block code is known as n comma k code. So n is the number of bits in the code vector, and k is the number of bits in the message vector. So that we have discussed already in the last class. And once you get the code vector C, then there is a possibility that this code vector is being disturbed by some externally present noise signal. And as a matter of fact, the code signal, code word or code vector, which you have transmitted from the transmitter end and which you are receiving at the receiver end might not be the same. But if I consider that there is no error, and under this condition, if I just once again try to decode the vector or try to understand whether any error has been pipped or not, then that can be done using a decoder, using a parity check matrix like H, and the input was C, and we will be computing CH transpose. And if the CH transpose, if the resultant value is equal to 0, although it's not a scalar 0, it's a vector, because as you know, C will be having a dimension of 1 cross n, and H transpose will be having a dimension of n cross n minus k. So n cross n minus k. And ultimately, this 0, this is nothing but a null vector of dimension 1 cross n minus k. C is having a dimension of 1 cross n. So if you get this null vector of dimension 1 cross n minus k, then you can say that the received signal is a code vector, is a valid code vector, but you are not sure whether this was the actual code vector which you have transmitted. But in most of the cases, we expect that the error signal, which is disturbing the code word, is not equal to any other code vector. So as a matter of fact, if you get that this CH transpose, this value is equal to 0, it's a null vector, then you can say that there is no error. On the other hand, if CH transpose, the product of these two different matrices, if the corresponding result is not equal to a null vector, then obviously you can say that the error has been there in the code vector. So error detection can be easily done by just observing this particular vector, C into H transpose. If this is equal to 0, we can say that there is no error. And if this is not equal to 0, then we can say that there is certain error present within the code vector. Then after error detection part is over, then we have to find out the possible location of the error, and which is known as the error correction. Once you can identify the error pattern, then what you can do is that you can subtract this error pattern from the code word, then you can get the original transmitted code vector. And since we are using the modulo 2 kind of addition, last day I have mentioned that in this particular case, 1 plus 1 is not equal to 2, rather 1 plus 1 is equal to 0. So the addition was like this. So 0 plus 0 is equal to 0, 0 plus 1 is equal to 1, 1 plus 0 is equal to 1, and 1 plus 1 is equal to 0. So this is not a normal addition, and this is neither a normal addition nor a simple OR operation in binary logic. Rather, it's a kind of exclusive OR. So 1 plus 1 will be equal to 0 in this particular case. So whenever the code vector is there, this C, and the receipt vector, if I consider the receipt vector R, so this R can be represented as C plus E. So C is the code vector. This was the code vector which has been transmitted from the transmitter side, and this is known as the error vector. Now, as you can understand, if I write like 1 plus 1 is equal to 0 in this particular exclusive OR logic, so if I want to get C out of R, that can be done through either you can say that, okay, algebraically it seems that C is given by R minus E. This is algebraically true. But if I just follow the logic, the exclusive OR logic over here, and if I add E in both sides of this equation, then what you find is R plus E is equal to C plus E plus E. Now, as far as the logic of XOR is concerned, this E plus E will give you always zero, because we have already mentioned that if the two bits are same, then the result will be zero. And if the two bits are different, then the result will be one. So that is the condition, or that is the property of a exclusive OR algorithm. So from this expression, what we can find is C can be represented as R plus E. So instead of just subtracting E, you can add E with the receipt vector, then you can get what is known as the correct error, correct code word, which has been transmitted from the transmitter side. So all you need to do here is to identify the error pattern. So once you can identify the error pattern, if the value is not equal to zero, that value C into H transpose is not equal to zero, then you are sure that there is a kind of error pattern. Some error is there. So R value is not equal to C, because if R is equal to C, then the corresponding value C into H transpose or R into H transpose will become zero. But since the resultant value C into H transpose is not equal to zero, that means in this case, we should say that R into H transpose is not equal to zero, then obviously some error has been there, and we have to identify that error. And once you can identify that error, then you can add the error vector with the receipt vector R to get the actually transmitted code vector, that is C. So C can be represented by R plus E. So here our objective in this particular lecture is to identify the error pattern, and we have to find out the limit up to which we can identify the error pattern. Is it possible to identify any error pattern, or there is certain limitation in this identification process? So that will be discussed in detail in this particular lecture. And more specifically, technically, that particular discussion can be regarded as the error correction. So error detection part has already been discussed in the last. Now, today, I'll be talking about the error correction part, whether you can correct the error. So first of all, to correct any error pattern, I mean, to correct any code vector, you have to identify the error pattern. And once you can identify the error pattern, then you can add the error pattern with the receipt vector to obtain the code vector. Now, first of all, this operation involves the computation of a particular vector. Already we have discussed in the last day, and this computation is given by, suppose R is the receipt vector and H is nothing but your parametric matrix. So then this R H transpose, this particular thing, which is equal to S, and this is known as the syndrome. So depending upon the value of this S, you can decide whether the received signal is in error or not, whether the received code word is in error or not. So if s is equal to 0, you may say that there is no error. And if s is not equal to 0, remember that s is a vector. So although I'm writing like 0, so remember it's a vector. It's not a scalar quantity. That means there is an error. There is error. And once there is error, you have to identify that error pattern. So first of all, you have to compute this syndrome. So syndrome calculation is very important, and the entire error correction part is based on syndrome. So that's why it is also known as a syndrome-based decoding and syndrome-based error correction. Now, before I say anything further, let me tell you some of the properties of this syndrome. So the first property, property number one, which I should mention here, is the syndrome depends on the error pattern only. Syndrome depends on error pattern. That means we have the received vector R, which is equal to the actually transmitted code vector plus the error pattern, C plus E, I can write. Now, if I just consider this E, remember that E is also a vector and whose dimension is equal to the dimension of C. So far, we have assumed that C is having a dimension 1 cross n. So it's a row vector of dimension n. So we have n number of such bits. So the vector E is also having the same dimension of 1 cross n. And if I add two vectors of same dimension, we can get a new vector of dimension 1 cross n, and which is known as a received vector. Now, for example, let me give you one example over here. Say C is given by, this is the code vector, say 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0. Suppose this is the code vector. And suppose the error vector is given by 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So it is more likely that most of the bits will be transmitted without an error, but there could have been some bits which are altered. So there are 8 bits in this particular error vector, and out of 8 bits, say only one bit is there, and which can disturb the actual code word. So ultimately, if I just once again observe the received vector, so received vector will look like, so whenever you have 0, since the addition is a modulo 2 kind of addition, so whenever you have 0, you can directly write the actual code vector over here. But if you have 1, the corresponding value will be inverted. So if you have 1 over here, it will be 0. And if you have 0 over here, it will be 1. Because the third position, you have 1 over here. So ultimately, the received vector will be 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0. So out of 8 bits, so there are altogether 8 bits, and out of 8 bits, all the 7 bits, they are as it is, but the third bit, as you understand, the third bit is in error, because in the error vector, the third bit position, we have a 1 over here. So if I just once again go back to the property of the syndrome, then you'll see that the received vector is given by R, that is equal to C plus E. Then how to calculate the syndrome? The syndrome calculation is given by, the formula is S, that is equal to R into H transpose. The received vector multiplied with this particular value, H transpose. So I can write R as C plus E into H transpose. And from the property of matrix multiplication, we can write C into H transpose plus E into H transpose. I'm taking the help of distributive property of matrix multiplication. So as you know, C into H transpose is always equal to 0, because C is a valid code word. And the property says that C into H transpose must be equal to 0. So the result equal to E into H transpose. So if I just try to correlate S, the syndrome, with its value, you'll see that it has nothing to do with the code word which you have transmitted. Whether you transmit C1, C2, C3, C4, doesn't matter. The ultimate value of the syndrome depends upon the error pattern, that is E. So the first property is satisfied, first property is proved, that syndrome depends only on the error pattern. That is a very important property in finding out the corresponding error pattern and to correct it accordingly. So this is the first property of the syndrome. And the second property says that it says that all the error patterns or error vectors, you can also say, all the error vectors which differ by a code word must have the same syndrome. What does it mean? All the error vectors which differ by a code word must have the same syndrome. So let us start with any particular value of the error vector. Let it be represented by E. And from this, let us try to formulate a set of error vectors which differ by a code word. So E is a particular error vector. And if I add CI with it, that can be represented as EI, for example, where I can be 1, 2, 3, up to 2 to the power k, for example. If I have, say, k number of different code vectors. So as you know, let me once again summarize that part. This conversion M to C. So M is having a dimension of 1 cross K and C is having a dimension of 1 cross N. And lastly, I've also mentioned that this conversion from M to C is a 1-to-1 mapping. So for a particular M, you would be having a particular C. Now, since the number of bits present in the message vector is K, so there could have been at most 2 to the power k different message vector, and for each 2 to the power k different message vectors, you will be having 2 to the power k unique code vectors. So although the length of the code vector is n, but the possible valid code vector is equal to 2 to the power k. So if I just represent the different code vectors within the code set by ci, where I can range from 1, 2, 3 up to 2 to the power k, then if I add this each of CI with a particular error vectors, then this set of these error vectors EI, it satisfies this property that all the error vectors which differ by a code word. So all the elements within the set EI, so they are different from each other by means of one code vector. Because if I consider the first one, it will be E plus C1. The second one will be E plus C2. So what is the difference between them? This is nothing but C2 minus C1. And C2 minus C1 is also equal to some other code vector because this is the property of the linear block code. That means the addition, the modulo 2 addition of two code vector will be giving you some other code vector. So therefore, if I consider that particular set EI, so there are altogether 2 to the power k different elements, 2 to the power k different members given by E plus CI. For I is equal to 1 to 2 to the power k. So all these error vectors, that means all the vectors within that particular set EI, so they differ from one another by a code word only. Now let us try to calculate the syndrome of this particular error vectors. Now how to calculate the syndrome? So syndrome can be calculated like the same property we have to use, that is EI into H transpose. So that can be represented as E plus CI into H transpose. So once again, let me invoke the distributive property, that is E into H transpose plus Ci into H transpose. And as you know, Ci into H transpose for all I from 1 to 2 to the power k, that value will be equal to 0 because Ci is a valid code word. So ultimately, you are left with E into H transpose for all I 1, 2, up to 2 to the power k. So therefore, if I consider all the 2 to the power k elements within that particular set of error vectors, so they are characterized by the same syndrome. And the syndrome value is equal to E into H transpose. And the set of these code vectors, or these error vectors rather, this set of this EI is known as the coset of the code. This set is known as coset of the code. Coset. That means if I consider all the elements within a coset, so they are characterized by same syndrome. So the syndrome is given by E into H transpose. Now with these two properties, let us try to identify how can we correct the error pattern, or how can we identify the error pattern, and then accordingly we can correct the corresponding code vector. Now to proceed further, let us try to have few other definitions pertaining to the code vectors. The first definition is about the Hamming distance. So what do you mean by the Hamming distance? So suppose we have two different code vectors like C1 and C2 of similar dimension, say let it be 1 cross n and 1 cross n respectively. Then the Hamming distance between these two code vectors is given by the number of positions, the number of locations where the corresponding bits differ. So Hamming distance between any two code words of similar dimension or same dimension is equal to the number of bit positions where the corresponding bits differ. So let me give you an example so that you can understand. Suppose C1 is given by 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. And C2, so the dimension for C1 is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And suppose C2 is given by 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. So both of them are having a dimension of 1 cross 8. So the Hamming distance between these two code words, which can be represented by DC1, C2, is obtained by identifying the bit positions, the number of locations where the corresponding bits differ. So this is the first, if I just consider the first position, so C1 and C2, they are having different values. For C1, the value is 1, for C2, the value is 0. For second position, they are the same. Third position, they are the same. Fourth position, they are the same. Once again, in the fifth position and in the sixth position, you will see that the corresponding bits differ. So how many bits? In the first position, then we have second, third, fourth, then we have fifth position, and then at the sixth position. So there will be three locations where the corresponding bits differ. So the Hamming distance between these two code words is given by 3 only. So that is the idea behind the Hamming distance. And then we have another important parameter, which is known as the Hamming weight. What do you mean by the Hamming weight? So Hamming weight for any particular code vector is given by the total number of non-zero bits. Total number of non-zero bits. So that is nothing but the Hamming weight. So if I consider the previous example over here, so how many non-zero bits you can find in C1? So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And how many non-zero bits you are getting in C2? 1, 2, 3, 4. So accordingly, one can write the Hamming weight for C1. So W of C1, Hamming weight of C1 is given by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that is 5. And the Hamming weight of C2 is given by 1, 2, 3, 4. So Hamming weight is nothing but the total number of non-zero bits. So how many non-zero bits are there within a particular code vector? That is equal to the Hamming weight. So there is a relationship, as you can understand, between the Hamming weight and Hamming distance. So I can also say that the Hamming weight of any particular code vector is nothing but the Hamming distance between that code vector and the all zero code vector. That is quite obvious. Hamming weight of any code vector is also equivalently represented by, so this Hamming weight is nothing but, in terms of Hamming distance, I can say that this is the Hamming distance between the code word and all zero code word. So whenever we say Hamming distance, so it is defined on two different code vectors like C1 and C2. And when the Hamming weight is defined, it is defined on a single parameter like C1 or C2. So therefore, if I want to represent the Hamming weight in terms of Hamming distance, so this is given by the Hamming distance between the code word itself and the all zero code word. And then comes the third important variable in this particular analysis, and which is known as the minimum distance. And minimum distance, whenever we say minimum distance, so minimum distance is defined for a code. That means a set of code vectors. So you have to identify the argument for each of these parameters. So whenever we consider Hamming weight, so Hamming weight is defined for a single vector. The Hamming weight for C1, Hamming weight for C2, Hamming weight for C3, and so on. So this is defined for a single vector. And Hamming distance is defined for a set of two vectors, pair of vectors, C1, C2, C1, C3, C2, C4, C5, C6, like this. And whenever we say minimum distance, so minimum distance is defined over a set of code vectors. So last day we have mentioned that the set of code vectors is being represented by the curly C, which is nothing but C1, C2, C3, up to C2 to the power k. So set of all code vectors is known as the code. So this is known as the code. And minimum distance is defined over a code. So what do you mean by the minimum distance? So minimum distance is given by the minimum. So it can be defined either in terms of Hamming distance or in terms of Hamming weight. And as you know, this Hamming weight and Hamming distance can be interchangeably used depending upon the corresponding application. So minimum distance of a code is defined as the minimum Hamming distance between any two code vectors. This is given by the minimum Hamming distance between any two code words. So if I have, say, 2 to the power, say, if I have, say, 10 number of code words in a particular code, or let it be, say, 16 code words. For example, if k is equal to 4, then we have 16 code words. For k is equal to 4, this curly C will be consisting of 16 elements. So accordingly, if I have 16 elements, so there could have been 16 C2 possible combinations, 16 C2. So you can calculate 16 C2 number of Hamming distance, C1 and C2, C1 and C3, C1 and C4, C1 and C5, C1 and C6, up to C1 and C16, then C2, C3, C2, C4, C2, C5, and so on. So as far as your knowledge in permutation combination goes, you understand that there could have been 16 C2 possible combinations. And as you can understand that Hamming distance between C1 and C2 and Hamming distance between C2 and C1 being the same. So there is no change. That means I can also write this one. So C1 and C2 and C2 and C1 will be having the same Hamming distance. If I just calculate the corresponding locations where the bits are differing. So out of the 16 C2 possible Hamming distance, the minimum value of it is given by the minimum distance of the code. So minimum distance of a code is given by the minimum Hamming distance between any pair of code vectors within the code cell. Now with these three understanding on Hamming distance, Hamming weight and minimum distance, let us now try to understand how can we ultimately detect the corresponding error, identify the corresponding error vector, and accordingly we can correct it. Now to do that, let me start with the syndrome. And as you have already mentioned, the syndrome S value is ultimately given by E into S transpose. And the vector is having a dimension of 1 cross n minus k. Because E is having a dimension of 1 cross n and H transpose is having a dimension of n cross n minus k. So ultimately, S will be having a dimension of 1 cross n. Suppose E0, E1, E2, up to the last element will be E of n minus 1. And H, this matrix we have already discussed in the last day. This is given by I n minus k and P transpose like this. Then how can we represent this P? It was like P00, P01, P02. Then we have P0. N minus k minus 1. The next element will be P10, P11, P12. So for I n minus k, it will be having a dimension of n minus k cross n minus k. So therefore, P transpose is having a dimension of n minus k cross k. So that ultimately this H is having a dimension of n minus k cross n. So in P, we have A rows and n minus k columns. So accordingly, we can write it will be say P1. So this element will be P1, comma n minus k minus 1 and so on, and the last element will be like pk minus 1 comma 0, pk minus 1 comma 1, and the last element will be pk minus 1 comma n minus k minus 1, like this. So this is the formulation of the matrix P. Now what we are doing here, we are multiplying this E with the H transpose. So whenever you multiply with H transpose, that means you are multiplying the corresponding elements E0, E1, E2 with the corresponding rows of the matrix H. So ultimately, if I just find out the elements for S, the first element will be S0. That S0 can be represented as S0 can be represented as, first we have the identity matrix, so this element will be E0. Then we have zeros, n minus k minus 1 zeros. Then we have E, n minus k, P0, 0, 0 plus E, n minus k plus 1 into P10 plus dot dot, the last element will be E n minus 1 into P K minus 1 0. The second element of the syndrome is given by E1, and then all the elements will be 0, and ultimately we have E n minus k P01 plus E n minus k plus 1 P11, and the last element will be E of n minus 1 P k minus 1 1. So in this way, we have to identify all the elements of the vector syndrome. And the last element will be Sn minus k minus 1. As you can understand, this syndrome is a vector of dimension 1 cross n minus k. So the last element will be E n minus k minus 1 plus E n minus k P 0 comma n minus k minus 1 plus E n minus k plus 1 P 1 comma n minus k minus 1, and the last element will be E n minus 1 P k minus 1 comma n minus k minus 1. So ultimately, each of these elements is S0, S1 up to S of n minus k minus 1. So altogether, we have n minus k elements, S0 to S of n minus k minus 1. And each of them are scalar quantities, because E0, E1, E2, E3 up to En, so they can assume values within the set 0 to 1. And similarly, all the elements within the matrix H, so they can also value, they can also assume values like either 0 or 1. So ultimately, whenever you just find out this expression E0 plus this En minus k into P00 like this, so this is nothing but the result will be either 0 or 1, because we are following the modulo 2 kind of addition. So 0 into 0 will be 0, 0 into 1 will be 0, 1 into 0 will be 0, and 1 into 1 will be 1. And 0 plus 0 equal to 0, 1 plus 1 is equal to 0, 0 plus 1 is equal to 1, and 1 plus 0 is equal to 1. So that multiplication and addition formula has to be followed, and ultimately the elements S0, S1, S2 up to S of n minus k minus 1, they can assume value either 0 or 1, depending upon the result. So once you calculate the syndrome, so you have this vector with you, you have the vector S available with you. So what is the dimension of the vector? The dimension is 1 cross n minus k. So you have n minus k different values. Now P00, P10, this is already known to you, because once you generate this matrix from the transmitter side, so already you know everything about the construction of the matrix P, and as well as the construction of the matrix G and H. Because G is constructed from P and identity matrix, and H is constructed from the P transpose and another identity matrix. So once you know this P, this particular formulation of P, then obviously you will be knowing what will be the corresponding value of H and G. So P00, P10, so all the values are known to you. The unknown quantity is nothing but this value, E0, E1, E2 up to En minus 1. So how many unknowns do you have? So you have n unknowns in the form of e0, e1, e2 up to en minus 1. Because once you can identify these different elements like e0, e1, e2, and en minus 1, then you can clearly understand which particular bit has been altered by means of this error vector. So we have n number of unknowns, e0 to en minus 1. Now you have to identify these n unknowns from n minus k equations. So you have n minus k known values in the form of s0 to s of n minus k minus 1. So you have n minus k known values, and using this n minus k known values, you have to ultimately determine n unknowns. Now this is a system of linear equations, so you have n minus k number of linear equations, and using this n minus k number of linear equations, you have to identify or you have to determine n unknowns, which is impossible because the number of known variable is less as compared to the number of unknown variables. So therefore, if you make any attempt to find out the values of e0 up to en minus 1 from the set of these equations, so you will be having undeterministic solution. So syndrome based calculation will not directly guide you in identifying the error pattern or in finding out the error pattern, but you have to follow certain mechanism so that this syndrome based calculation, syndrome based decoding, will help you in reaching your goal, and that is known as the syndrome based decoding. Now for this particular purpose, we have to devise some algorithm. Now what is that algorithm? Let us once again start from the syndrome expression. You will see that there are more number of unknowns as compared to the number of known values, and as you know, the syndrome depends only on the error pattern. That was a property, that was the second, first property which we have discussed today. The syndrome depends only on the error pattern. So therefore, if I have some error patterns and if they differ by some code words, then they will be having the same syndrome. That means we have an error pattern over here E, and ultimately we are getting some S0 S1 of S of N minus K minus 1. And let this E be substituted by E plus some C1. And once again, if you calculate the syndrome, you will see that you are getting the same value, S0 S1 of S of N minus K minus 1. Although the actual error value was different. What I mean to say is, you have certain error, say E, you are getting some syndrome, say S. So this is a vector. So you have like S0, S1, S2, up to S of N minus K minus 1, N minus K variables. Let us consider another variable, another vector like E plus C1. Let me erase that part. Let us consider another vector like E plus C1. It will also give you the same syndrome because it depends upon the error. And on the other hand, if I have another error like E plus C2, this will also give you the same syndrome. So just by observing these N minus K variables, for each of them, E, E plus C1, E plus C2, and up to E plus C, 2 to the power k minus 1, if I consider. So for all of them, the corresponding syndrome will be the same. So just by observing these variables, S0, S1, S2, up to S of N minus K minus 1, just by observing N minus K variables, it is not possible to identify which particular error is responsible for creating the received vector. It might be due to E, it might be due to E plus C1, it might be due to E plus C2, and so on. So this is one of the limitation of this kind of decoding. So we have to take the help of this, obviously, and taking the help of this type of decoding, we have to ultimately come up with a solution. So ultimately, what you can say is this E, E plus C1, E plus C2. So actually, they are following the formula like this. They are following E plus CI, that is equal to EI. So these code vectors are added with any particular error pattern, that is E, and E plus CI is equal to EI. So all of them can be represented by some EI. And as you know, this EI is nothing but the coset. EI is known as the coset of the code, and all of them are characterized by the same syndrome. Now, since all of them are characterized by the same syndrome, then just by observing the syndrome value, you will not be able to identify the corresponding error pattern, which is responsible for creating the receipt vector. So what alternative do we have at this moment so that we can identify? Now to do that, let us impose certain limitations or certain constraints on the code word itself or on the code set itself. It is said that we have received a vector R that we know is given by C plus E. Now just by observing R, you have to associate this R with that particular code vector for which the Hamming distance between the received vector and the code vector is the minimum. Let me repeat once again. Since I do not have a deterministic solution from the syndrome-based decoding, because we have n minus k number of known values and we need to determine n number of unknowns. And since n is greater than n minus k, so having n minus k known values, it is not possible to find out n unknowns. So therefore, the decoding has to take some different route to ultimately get the solution. And to obtain the solution, we need to take the help of the notion of Hamming distance, Hamming weight, and the minimum distance. So already we have discussed what is meant by the Hamming distance, what is meant by the Hamming weight, and what is meant by the minimum distance. Now here the idea is you have got some receipt vector, and suppose since this code vector is being represented by some 1 cross n vector of dimension 1 cross n, so it will be possible to represent that particular vector on an n dimensional space by means of a point like this. Suppose this point is being represented on an n dimensional space. So suppose this is C1. Suppose we do have another code vector like C2. We do have another code vector like here C3, depending upon the values of zeros and ones. Now you have got the receipt vector like R. Similarly, you can also represent the receipt vector by means of a point on n dimensional space. Suppose this is R. Let me use some different color over here for the receipt vector. Suppose the receipt vector is being represented by that particular point. Then you have all together 2 to the power k number of possible code vectors, C1, C2, C3, up to C2 to the power k, and they can be represented on a two-dimensional space, n-dimensional space, if the length of the code vector is n. So similarly, you can also represent the receipt vector on an n-dimensional space. And if there is certain error, if R is not exactly equal to C, then obviously the R will not be lying on any of the code vectors. If the error value is equal to zero, then R will be lying on that particular code vectors, and ultimately you'll be getting the syndrome value is equal to a null vector, and you can easily identify that there is no error and the received code vector is perfectly okay. But because of the presence of noise, because of the presence of the error signal, there might be one bit which is in error, and for which The receipt vector and the code vector is being represented by two different points on an n-dimensional space. Suppose the code vector is represented by C1, C2, C3, and so on. So there could have been some other code vectors also. And suppose the receipt vector is being represented by this particular point, as identified by this green. Then, given this receipt vector, the decoder has to identify the Hamming distance between the receipt vector and each of the code vectors, C1, C2, C3, up to C2 to the power k. And if I consider only three values over here, or let it be say, let me add another point. I think it will be better if I represent it on a two-dimensional scale. I think it will be fine if I mention the C4 over here. Suppose C4 is being represented over here. So, if one can observe the distance, Hamming distance between R and C1, Hamming distance between R and C4, R and C2 and R and C3. So one can easily identify that the Hamming distance between R and C1 is the minimum. Now, since the Hamming distance between R and C1 is minimum, then one can easily say that the receipt vector corresponds to the code vector C1. Now, the situation is not so easy as we are mentioning over here. Now, let us try to explain the same thing using two different code vectors. Suppose the code vectors are being represented by C1 and C2. So they are being represented on a n-dimensional space. And let us impose some constraint, some limitation on the error pattern. The limitation is that the error vectors are having a Hamming weight of P, maximum Hamming weight, let me write. The error vectors are having a maximum Hamming weight of P. So now, for each of these code vectors, what I can do is I can draw a sphere. It will be a sphere, it will be not a circle, because make no mistake that conceptually, these code vectors are being represented on n-dimensional space. But here we are representing on a 2D screen. Similarly, for C2, we can draw another sphere. And the radius will be T. The radius will be T. This is the radius. That is T. So the limitation is that the error vectors can have a maximum Hamming weight of T. So the error vectors are being represented by 1 cross n vector. Now, out of those n bits, at most, T number of bits can have 1. At most, T number of bits can have 1. And if we have 1 in a particular position within the error vector, then the corresponding location of the code vector will be modified or altered, as we have already mentioned, or as we have already discussed. I think we have discussed over here. So we do have 8 elements, 8 bits in the code vector, 8 bits in the error vector, and out of 8 bits, only 1 bit is in error. And how to identify the corresponding bits? So this bit corresponds to that particular location where the error vector is having a non-zero entry. We are following the modulo 2 addition, XOR kind of addition. So if I have a non-zero entry like this, then the corresponding bit will be inverted. If we have 1 over here, it will be inverted to 0. If we have 0 over here, it will be inverted to 1. So now, for this decoding purpose, we are imposing a constraint, a limitation, in the sense that the maximum Hamming weight of the error vector is equal to t. That means, what is the Hamming weight? Hamming weight is defined by the maximum number, the number of non-zero bits, total number of non-zero bits. So within the error vector, I can have at max t number of non-zero entry. So if I have n number of elements within the error vector, then at most t position will be occupied by 1. It might be less than t, but cannot exceed t. For example, if n is equal to 8, and if I impose this t is equal to 2, then at most 2 positions are occupied by 1, either first and second, or first and fifth, or second and fourth, or second and eighth, like this. But I can't have more than 2 positions which are occupied by 1 within the error vector. So that is the condition. Now, under this condition, suppose C1 has been transmitted. Now, if C1 is being transmitted, we can conceptually create a sphere across C1, keeping C1 at the center. We can conceptually think of a sphere with C1 at its center, and the dimension of, and the radius of the corresponding sphere is given by t. Then if C1 is being transmitted, then you can easily understand that the received vector must belong within the sphere constructed by C1. Because the received vector r can be represented by some C1 plus e. Now we know that e is having some limitation in the form that the maximum Hamming weight of e is given by t. So that means if I form a sphere over here with a radius of t, then the received vector must lie within the sphere. Similarly, if the transmitted code word is C2, and if the condition is that the error vectors are having a maximum Hamming weight of t, then the received vector must lie within this particular sphere. Suppose the received vector is presented over here, then one can easily say that received vector belongs to or corresponds to C2. Now, if the received vector belongs to in this particular sphere, then one can easily say that the received vector corresponds to the code vector C1. Now, this type of decoding is only feasible when the code vectors are far apart. Or in other words, so here I have shown only 2 different code words, but in reality, there could have been 2 to the power k number of possible code words. And accordingly, we have to construct 2 to the power k number of possible spheres. Now, this type of decoding is only possible when these spheres are non-overlapping. That means if they are disjoint in nature, then there is no problem. If they are disjoint, then there is no problem. How to ensure that they are disjoint? As you can understand, the distance between these 2 centers can be represented by the Hamming distance, that is dc1, c2. That distance should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. Now, if this condition gets satisfied, that the Hamming distance between 2 arbitrarily selected code words like C1 and C2, if the distance is greater than or equal to 2t plus 1, then the proposition can identify the error vectors with a maximum Hamming weight of t, and ultimately it can also correct it. On the other hand, let us consider a different scenario. Suppose C1 is present over here and C2 is present over here, and let me draw a sphere across C1 and across C2 as well. So that is the T And for C2, for example, we have got a sphere like this. And as you can clearly observe that these two spheres, they are not disjoint. There is an overlapping. And this is the overlap position. Now, what happens if the receipt vector, this is the overlap position. Now, what happens if the receipt vector belongs to this overlap position? If the receipt vector is over here, you can easily identify that it belongs to C2. If the receipt vector is over here, you can easily say that it belongs to C1. But if the receipt vector belongs to the overlap position, the common area for each of the spheres, then there is a possibility of error. Either you will decide in favor of C1 or you decide in favor of C2. Now, that is only possible when the dC1, C2 value, I mean, the Hamming distance is less than 2t plus 1. If it is less than 2t plus 1, then obviously there will be an overlapping. The spheres are not disjoint. Now, if dC1, C2 is greater than 2t plus 1, then the spheres are disjoint in nature. And if they are disjoint in nature, then you can easily identify the corresponding code vectors for a particular receipt vector. Now, this dC1, C2 has been computed for a particular pair of code vectors like C1 and C2. Now, you have to ensure that that condition must hold good for all such pairs. So if I have 2 to the power k code vectors in my set, so we can have altogether 2 to the power k C2 number of possible Hamming widths, 2 to the power k number of C2 number of possible Hamming widths, Hamming distance. Possible Hamming distance. Because we have C1, C2, C3 up to C2 to the power k. For k is equal to 4, we have 16 such elements. So accordingly, we can have 16 C2 number of possible Hamming distance. And for each of these Hamming distance, I have to ensure that it should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. So if I consider any such value like C1, C2, C1, C3, C1, C4, and so on, even the minimum value of that should be greater than 2t plus 1. And what is the minimum value of this? dC1, C2. This is nothing but the minimum distance. So therefore, to ensure that this type of algorithm is capable enough to identify any error patterns having a maximum Hamming weight of t, then the condition is that d min value, which is nothing but the minimum distance of that code word, of that particular code set, should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. In other words, if I know the d min value, because it has been already constructed a priori before the error takes place, because initially we have the message vector, and from the message vector we have to construct the corresponding matrix, G matrix, and from the G matrix we can easily find out the code vector pertaining to the message vector. So once you construct the set of code vectors, so you can easily find out what is the value of the minimum distance. So given the value of minimum distance, then you can identify what about the maximum value of the Hamming weight within the error vector, which that particular algorithm is capable to correct. And that value is given by t, where t is less than or equal to half of d minimum minus 1. And the value could have been fraction, so therefore let us take the float function over here. But as you understand the meaning of this, this will give you the maximum integer Just a minute. This will give you maximum integer. Less than x. For example, if the value is like say 2.3, this will give you 2. If the value is like 7.5, this will give you 7. This is known as the float function. The maximum integer less than the value of x. Because as you understand, the value of t cannot be a fraction. It will be either 1 or 2 or 3 or 4. So it will be an integer value because the Hamming weight, Hamming distance, minimum distance, so all of them will be integer. Suppose d mean is equal to some even value. Suppose d mean is equal to 6, then 6 minus 1, that is 5. 5 by 2, that is 2.5. So the value of t should be 2 or less than 2. Then only this particular decoding process will be able to identify the error, and accordingly it can correct the error. So now we are in a position to ultimately decode the corresponding error pattern, and accordingly we can correct it. So this is known as syndrome based decoding. So for syndrome-based decoding, first of all, the first step is that you have to identify 2 to the power k disjoint sets, just like we have drawn pictorially. For each of the code vectors, C1, C2, C3, up to C2 to the power k, we have to construct the corresponding spheres. So first of all, we have to identify 2 to the power k disjoint sets or construct 2 to the power k number of disjoint sets. Like say D1, D2, up to D2 to the power k. So how to construct it? So initially we have to start from the all zero code vector. So C1, let it be C1, C1 is equal to 0. All zero code vector. Then we have C2, C3, C4. And the last element will be C2 to the power k. Then we pick a error value, say E2 over here. And we add E2 with each of the elements in the first row. So the second row is constructed like this, C2 plus E2. I think it will be better if I put some distance. So this will be C3, C3 will be C4, and the last value is C2 to the power k. So the next row is constructed by adding C2 with, it will be E2 plus C3. It will be better if I write E2 first. Okay. So this will be E2 plus C2. This will be E2 plus C3. This will be E2 plus C4. And ultimately the last value will be E2 plus C2 to the power k. Next we select another error pattern like E3. And this will be E3 plus C2. This will be E3 plus C3. This will be E3 plus C4. And the last element will be E3 plus C2 to the power k. So in this way, we have to construct this array, which is known as the standard array. And in fact, we will be exploiting all the 2 to the power n possible patterns, because each of the elements, I mean, each of the received vectors, so they are having a length of n. And since each of the bits are being represented by either 0 or 1, so there could have been all 2 to the power 2 to the power n possibilities. Out of these 2 to the power n possibilities, 2 to the power k are the valid code words, and the rest are the error pattern. So ultimately, the last value will be e 2 to the power n minus k. It will be e 2 to the power n minus k plus c2. So plus C2 E2 to the power n minus k plus C3, and the last element will be like E2 to the power n minus k plus C2 to the power k. So now we have to identify the disjoint sets. So 2 to the power k disjoint sets. So this corresponds to 1. So the columns will correspond to the disjoint sets. So this is the first disjoint set. C1, E2, E3 up to E2 to the power n minus k. Second disjoint set is C2, E2 plus C2, E3 plus C2 up to E2 to the power n minus k, C2 like this. And then C3, E2 plus C3, E3 plus C3 and so on. So we have to construct 2 to the power k number of disjoint sets. And within this particular standard array, if I just go row wise, then row wise you'll see that there is an error pattern like E2, and then the other elements within that particular row is nothing but the different code words added with E2. So first element is E2, second element is E2 plus C2, E2 plus C3, E2 plus C4. So in fact, these rows will construct a particular coset. So this will construct a coset, this will construct another coset, and each of them are identified by a particular syndrome value. Because as you know, the syndrome value depends upon the error pattern only. And if as far as the second property of the syndrome is concerned, if the error patterns differ by code words, by one code word, then they will be having the same syndrome. So in fact, we have already discussed that part, that EI, suppose EI is given by E plus CI, then each of the EI will be having the same syndrome. So here, this can be represented, or this can be identified from each of the rows of the standard array. Here you'll see that each of the element can be written like E2 plus CI, each of the element here can be written like E3 plus CI, here E4 plus CI, and lastly E to the power 2, E of 2 to the power n minus k plus CI. So all of them will be having a same syndrome. All of the elements within a particular row will be having a same syndrome, and they are known as the coset. So this is one coset. So this is one coset. Then we have, this is another coset. Then we have, this is another coset like this. And they are identified by, this is another coset. So they are identified by a single syndrome. So the first step in syndrome-based decoding is to construct the 2 to the power k number of disjoint sets. Then the second step is compute the scene room. From the receipt vector. And scene room calculation is given by S is equal to R into H transpose. Now, if I just once again go back to the standard array, which you have been creating over here. Now, each of the elements within a particular row, they are characterized by a scene room. So first row will be having a scene room. Second row will be having another scene room. Third row will be having another scene room. So each of them will be having a particular value of the scene room. And in the second step, we have already computed the scene room from the receipt vector. Now, once you have computed the scene room from the receipt vector, then we have to check whether the computed scene room matches with the resultant scene room in the first row, or it matches with the resultant scene room in the second row or third row or not. Then you have to identify, in the third step, you have to identify the row in the standard array which corresponds to the computed scene room or calculated scene room. Suppose the value of the scene room which you have received from over here. So as you understand, this scene room is having a dimension 1 plus n minus k, and each of them, each of the rows will be having a different n minus k tuples. For this one, it will be 0 perhaps because the first element is equal to 0. For this one, we'll be having a different n minus k tuple, and you have to identify the corresponding row for which the computed scene room matches with the scene room of the particular row. And then the first element of each of the row is known as the coset leaders. They are known as the coset leaders. It's E2, E3, E2 to the n minus k. They are known as the coset leaders, the first element. Because just a minute. I think there has been certain problem with the presentation. Okay, the construction has been to some extent so I need to once again redraw, because the construction, there has been certain technical difficulty. So very quickly, let me draw it. Okay, this one we have discussed already, fine. So scene room based decoding. First of all, the first step was The construction of two to the power k disjoint subsets let it be d1, d2 up to d2 to the power k. And the second step is the formation of the standard array. Thirdly, you have to compute the corresponding syndrome from the receipt vector. And then you have to identify the coset leader from the received or from the computed syndrome. And the fifth step is correct the receipt vector by adding the coset leader to it. So what we have got is that the first element is zero, all zero vector. Then you have C2, then C3, C2 to the power k. So all the code vectors are being represented in the first row of the standard array. And the remaining rows are populated in this fashion. You have to identify any error pattern from the list. And while identifying the error pattern, you have to ensure that that error pattern has not encountered before. So once you get this error pattern, so accordingly, you can find out or you can populate the next rows. It will be 2 plus C2 to the power k. It will be E3 plus C2, E3 plus C3, and so on. And ultimately, the last element will be e of 2 to the power n minus k, because we have started from 1. So e to the power e of 2 to the power n minus k. And it will be e of 2 to the power n minus k plus C2 e of 2 to the power n minus k plus C3. And the last element will be e of 2 to the power n minus k plus C2 to the power k. So in fact, within the standard array, we have 2 to the power k number of columns and 2 to the power n minus k number of rows. That means 2 to the power n number of total elements. So we have exhausted all the 2 to the power n possible numbers within this particular standard array. So nothing is left. Since each of the code words or the receipt vector or the error vector, they are having a dimension of 1 cross n, and each of the location is being populated by either 0 or 1. So if I consider the entire search space, so there could have been at most 2 to the power n number of possible patterns. Out of this 2 to the power n number of possible patterns, there are 2 to the power k valid code vectors, and which are being represented in the first row, C1, C2, C3, up to C2 to the power k. And apart from that, all the elements, starting from the second row to the last row, all the elements, so they are nothing but the error patterns, errors. And therefore, each of them are having a particular syndrome. So this will be having a syndrome. Suppose this syndrome is being represented by, say, let it be, say, S of 1. This syndrome is being represented by S of 2. Remember that all them writing like S1, S2, but they are vectors of dimension 1 cross n minus k. So S of 3, and ultimately S of 2 to the power n minus k. So we will be having different syndromes. And for the first row, since all the elements in the first row are nothing but the code vectors, valid code vectors, so the syndrome value will be equal to 0. Apart from that, we have other values, and these are non-zeros, and depends upon the first element. So each of these rows, they are characterized by a particular syndrome value, S1, S2, S3, up to S of 2 to the power n minus k. And essentially, the syndrome value depends upon the first element, that is E2, E3, E4, and so on, because that the property has already been discussed, that it depends upon only on the error pattern. Now let us once again go back to the syndrome-based decoding, the steps of that. So we have already formulated the standard array, and we need to compute the syndrome from the received vector. So the transmitted vector, I mean the transmitted code word was either C2 or C3 or C4 or anything. Any element from the first row, that was the transmitted vector, transmitted code word. But because of the noise, because of the error, the received vector can be anything. And that belongs to the second to the last row. And we have exhausted the entire search space. So there could have been altogether 2 to the power n number of possible elements, total elements. So all of them are being represented within the standard array in 2 to the power n minus k number of rows and 2 to the power k number of columns. So ultimately, it will give you 2 to the power n number of possible elements. Now, once you compute the syndrome from the received vector, and then you have to identify the corresponding coset leader. So this E2, E3, E4, they are known as the coset leaders. So this row, so the elements in the first column, they are the coset leaders. And they ultimately identify the corresponding syndrome value. So once you have already computed the syndrome, then you have to check, or you have to identify the row which corresponds to that particular syndrome. Suppose the computed syndrome matches with S3. So this is the third row. And in the third row, you have to identify the corresponding coset leader. So each of the rows, they are nothing but the coset, and the first element of the row is nothing but the coset leaders. So if the computed syndrome matches with S3, then the selected coset leader is E3. So that is the step number 4, identify the coset leader from the computed syndrome. And then ultimately, you have to correct it. So how to correct? So if you can identify the coset leader, then the C dashed, that means the corrected value of the code word, is given by the received signal R plus the corresponding coset leader. So let it be C3, the coset leader, selected coset leader. Selected coset leader. Now this type of decoding is only possible whenever the previous condition holds good. The condition was that we have already established the condition. The condition was that d minimum, that means the minimum distance of the code, should be greater than 2t plus 1. So once you formulate the matrix G, that is a generator matrix, so you can easily find out what is the value of the minimum distance, because you can easily find out, you can easily calculate the Hamming distance between any two code vectors, between any pair of code vectors, and the minimum value of that will give you the minimum distance. Now, once you know the minimum distance, suppose the minimum distance is given by 3. So either 3 or greater than 3. That means if I consider the Hamming distance, so the Hamming distance should be 3 or greater than 3. So the minimum distance will be 3. So if the minimum distance is equal to 3, then following this particular equation, you understand the maximum error correction capability. So t value is equal to 1 here. D mean is greater than or equal to d plus 1. So from that, we can find out that t value is equal to 1. So this particular syndrome-based decoding will be able to identify and rectify at max one error within the code vector. That means the maximum Hamming weight of the error vector could be 1. If d mean is equal to 5, so in that case, the t value will be equal to 2. That means the maximum number of positions where the non-zero entries are there within the error vector can be 2. So these two positions or two bits can be rectified by the syndrome-based decoding. So to ensure that the syndrome-based decoding proves to be useful, then each of the coset leaders, as you have identified over here, E2, E3, E4, and so on, so they should be regarded as the most probable error patterns. They should be identified as most probable error patterns. And if I consider a binary symmetric channel, in case of binary symmetric channel, the error patterns which are having minimum Hamming weight, they are the most probable. So it is very unlikely that out of 8 bits, 5 bits are found in error. It is very unlikely. At max 1 or at most 2 bits might be found in error. So therefore, for binary symmetric channel, we find that the error patterns which are having a lower value of Hamming weight, they are more probable than the others. And these error patterns are placed as the coset leader. And accordingly, the cosets are formed, or accordingly, the rows of the standard errors are formed. And ultimately, after computing the syndrome from the receipt vector, you have to identify the rows corresponding to that particular syndrome. And from the rows itself, you can easily identify what is the coset leader corresponding to that syndrome. And once you get the coset leader, then you can add the coset leader as it is the code vector. It is the error vector which disturbs the code vector. And accordingly, you can find out the corrected version. Sometimes this type of encoding scheme, this type of error correction scheme proves to be useless, in a sense that suppose you have transmitted, say, code vector C2, that was the transmitted code vector. So this is the transmitted code vector C2. And the error is supposed given by, error value is given by E3 plus, say, C4. So E3 plus C4 is error, for example. So under this condition, the receipt vector is given by C2 plus E, that is equal to C2 plus E3 plus C4, that is equal to E3 plus C2 plus C4. Now, if you compute the corresponding syndrome, so S, that is equal to RH transpose, is given by E3 H transpose only, because C2 plus C4 H transpose will give you 0. So then you have to check the corresponding row for which the syndrome equals E3 H transpose. So from the standard array itself, you can identify that S3 is that particular syndrome, because S3 is given by E3 H transpose. So then you might think that the selected coset leader is equal to E3, assuming that this is the error vector. So what you need to do is that the receipt vector is given by C2 plus E, and the corrected corrected code vector is given by R plus the selected coset leader, that is E3. So what was R? R was given by E3 plus C2 plus C4. So E3 plus C2 plus C4, and plus you have additional E3. So E3 plus E3 will give you 0. So ultimately, you will identify that the corrected code vector was C2 plus C4. However, so received, or I mean corrected code vector is equal to, let it be say, C2 plus C4, although the transmitted code vector is only C2. So this happens whenever the error vector, this E, is having a Hamming weight which is not following that particular condition. The condition is that d mean, minimum distance, should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1, where t is the Hamming weight. This is the Hamming weight. Or I should write maximum Hamming weight. Of the error vectors. You can have defined error vector having defined Hamming weight. And at max, the value could be t. If it is more than t, then that particular condition will not be satisfied. Now, here in this particular case, you'll see that the e value, I mean the error vector, will be having a Hamming weight which does not follow this particular condition, that d mean is greater than or equal to t plus 1. So under this condition, you cannot identify the error pattern. In fact, the error was E3 plus C4, but you have erroneously identified that as only E3 by virtue of the syndrome-based decoding. And ultimately, the transmitted code vector was C2, and the corrected code vector was C2 plus C4, but you are not in a position to identify the C4 as a component of the error. So this is the one of the limitation of this syndrome-based decoding. And to get rid of that, you have to always ensure that the error pattern, which I am talking about, which we are going to correct, this error pattern must be having a Hamming weight. That means the number of ones present within the error pattern must be following this equation, this inequality, that it should be less than or equal to half d mean minus 1. If this condition gets satisfied, then you will be able to identify that error pattern. So hopefully in the next class, I will elaborate the same thing by means of an example, so that you can understand the notion of this syndrome-based decoding in a much better way. Now with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on syndrome-based decoding.